All right, here we are in the finals, and we've won the die roll, so that's nice. I think that's a good thing for this deck. This is a pretty easy mulligan, fairly a lot of expensive spells, only a one lander, so we'll just ship this one back. It's more like it. We'll keep this one. So, yeah, this actually looks okay. You know, we get to play a Jeromica Warrior, maybe a Graceblade Artisan, and have a Sandblast. wouldn't call it the pinnacle of excitement, but it's decent. And Valorous Stance doesn't hurt the cause. At least it's castable. Reckless Imp with Haste. Oof. That's aggressive. That's all we can do. Not hitting a land there is quite a big bummer. Put us in a much better spot, but that's okay. We're still significantly ahead in the damage race here, as our opponent can't block. Sabertooth Outrider. It's pretty good. Well, this is a spell that we can cast. It's not one that we actually really want to here, though. Yeah, I think I'd rather just try to trade for the Outrider. I think Racing is now off the table. We're taking six, only dealing three, and that's a deck with five cards in hand and in the dash colors. Like, this could get out of hand pretty quickly. So I'm just going to sit back and try to block the Sabertooth Outrider and maybe even go for Valorous Stance to give my creature indestructible. Okay, I can accept this as well. Okay. Taking two damage for the turn, not too bad. Now, having four draw steps and failing to hit a land is pretty frustrating, so we're going to have to just try to gut this one out. This could get really ugly. I mean, we can cast everything in our hand with three mana now that I get rid of that. Or I guess we have a 1/4 drop here, but I mean, cast, like, very easily. So it's not that bad. All right, what is the deal? I guess I'm just blocking the Sabertooth Outrider. And I'm going to accept a trade if my opponent lets me do it. Okay, trample. So that's huge. Taking 12, going to 2, and not even sure that keeping this thing alive does much here. Yeah, I guess I'll do it, though. I mean, I still take a ton of damage, but I can't really just not cast spells at this point. So I've got to hit a land here, and we do. And I just have to play the updraft elemental here, I believe. And leave back our Dromica Warrior to block Typhoid Rats. The problem is, of course, is that this is all just way too late. Any dash creature kills us, any burn spell, any pump basically kills us. That gives, you know, any type of, like, another Volcanic Rush, anything like that. Any removal spell kills us. This would leave us alive. Yeah, it has haste. All right. I thought we had a chance there for a second. But we do not. All right, well, we can certainly beat this deck. It's just that we have to run better with our draw steps. So let's bring in Erishan Cleric for a little bit of extra life gain. don't think I'm still not really in love with this one, so we'll leave that out still. Maybe an Ancient Carp comes in. Maybe a Negate. What cards are bad here? What are the cards we just really don't want to see against this deck? The Illusory Gains needs to come out, so that one's pretty easy. The Scion of Ugin is not one of our more powerful spells, but I don't think it's terrible either. I like all of this stuff. The Gleam is eh, but it can really turn the game quickly, so it's not too bad. All of those seem worth it. Everything else seems fine. Yeah, I don't think we need to bring in the Carp or the Negate. Here we go again with another Mulligan. And another one. Alright, well, this could be a short one. Hopefully not. But sometimes you don't get to play Magic when you play Magic, as you guys are all keenly aware, I'm sure. Okay, well, we've got a chance here. Gleam of Authority can take over the board. It's not likely to against what our opponent's up to here, but it is possible. Drawing an island next would be a big deal. Turn 3, Jeskai Infiltrator. Remember, it's unblockable if it's the only creature we have. It can be a huge deal. Any land would be fine, but an island would be a big deal. All right, well, I have to settle for an Erishan Cleric, which is actually decent here, too. Makes our Gleam of Authority, you know, something we can actually do. Okay, yep. All right, an island. This is good. I'm going to play the Jeskai Infiltrator here. And if my opponent taps out, we could even do some things here. All right, there's a Sabertooth Outrider. That's not too bad for us. I can force a trade. That doesn't really work in our favor. Opponent does actually have Formidable already somehow. So if I play Gleam of Authority on, say, the Jeskai Infiltrator, I can attack with it, put a counter on here or on here, but then it just ends up trading with the Outrider or getting double blocked, so that's not going to be good enough this time. I can also put Gleam of Authority on it and just say go. That works fine too. I can start building up counters where I get to untap and do it again. You know, I still have blocks on these two things, and I can take a hit from the Outrider and not worry about it. The downside here is that if my opponent just untaps and just snaps off the creature with Gleam on it, well, that is an issue. My other option is to play Sandstorm Charger, which doesn't really match up well with what we're doing so far. I think I'd rather just try to play the Gleam here. I think I'm going to put it on the Erishan Cleric. And just pass the turn back here. This way we're guaranteed to at least get a counter on the thing and make something big-ish. And if we get to untap with it, I mean, that's not too bad. Like, it can really start to get out of hand pretty quickly. We're going to take a whack here, though, no doubt about it. Okay, so he's representing that Volcanic Eruption card again. And we have to decide what kind of risk we want to take here in case my opponent actually has it. One option is just to not block. I think that's a not unreasonable choice here. We take 14 if our opponent has it. But that's not really the end of the world. We're at 23 already. We also could try to block one of the creatures. Like, I can put Jeskai Infiltrator in front of the Kolaghan Skirmisher and kind of force the issue a little bit, or even put the Infiltrator on the Screamreach Brawler and then bolster it. And that kind of forces the issue a little bit and says, well, look, if you want to get a freebie here, you're going to have to do something. That does mean that we lose our Jeskai Infiltrator, though, which has a decent shot of being able to just attack into whatever my opponent does next turn and even get flipped up and do the whole, you know, making a whole bunch of creatures thing, which is a pretty big deal. I think I am going to go ahead and block here, though. I'll just block here and make my opponent do something. All right, so they do have a Volcanic Rush. There's nothing I can do about that. So these are going to trade, which is fine. I'm going to take a little bit less damage, but I'm just going to bolster onto the Cleric here because that's a thing that's actually sticking around. All right, this is acceptable. That was my opponent's entire turn as well. So I think that I can live with that. So we'll bolster to get this thing going. Draw. Whisk away or just play the Charger. I think I just want to play the Charger. Face down. That way I still get to activate this thing. So I get to attack for free. And yeah, I just attack and then pass the turn back here. Because the counter is going to go on this thing. But I'd rather have my Erishin Cleric untapped for obvious reasons. Yeah, if we can survive this turn with our creatures intact, it puts us in a reasonable position where we can flip up the Charger or activate this or keep Whisk Away available and activate this. It really puts us kind of in the driver's seat. Having the Whisk Away available plus the flipping up the Sandstorm Charger is a pretty powerful option. Okay, there's the Morph. Are you going to give something haste again? All right, no attack. That's lovely. Bolster. Now this thing's going to be huge. 3-5 already. I like that. Drawing a land isn't bad here either. That means that our Sandstorm Charger gets to grow. So this thing is going to be... So for each +1/+1 counter, we remember that from the first match. So if we Megamorph, that puts another counter on it. And then we can also do this thing again. And we can do it in the order such that this is going to pick up both of the counters. And that's going to just make this thing absolutely huge, which is kind of sweet. So I'll go ahead and attack with this, but not with the other one. We're still at a fairly precarious life total. 12 looks high, but these dash decks can just pile on huge amounts of damage. And I think I'd rather leave this morph back to block this turn. All right, take 3. Go ahead. It's tempting to go ahead and just Megamorph there to get in a little extra damage, but I really want to leave Whisk Away up. I want to be able to block something here and kind of force my opponent to do something. You know, maybe they just attack with the morph. I just block. Just say, show me something. And then I can whisk it away, or I can grow my Sandstorm Charger if it gets big enough. And I think that flexibility is a big deal. And of course, In the event that that my opponent, let's say, just like plays a creature and passes or whatever, I can still flip up Sandstorm Charger and activate this. So it kind of works out. Ooh, what was that? I saw some delving happening here. Are we going to see an angler maybe? Just enough mana to do that. All right. Well, this is kind of what I wanted. All right, I'm going to block here. And I think I block here. Yeah, I'm going to block here and here and force the issue. My opponent's really got to do something here. And they have another Volcanic Rush. Okay, well, first things first, yes, that resolves. So that means that I need to get this thing even bigger. And then, yeah, I think this actually just works out perfect for us. I think I bolster now. That makes this thing big and this thing big. And then I just flip this up and these all get eaten and we take 4. Yeah, this works out really great. Because now this thing's 6. And then if I flip up, I get to Megamorph, make that a 5-7, and that thing eats that. What a blowout. Wow. We just smashed our opponent with that play. That was fantastic. Now we get to attack for 6, 11, 12. Wow. That's huge. Probably just 11 this turn. Nope. Never mind. The full amount. Because now we don't have to worry about a lot of different spells. Let's see here. So this is... Actually, they're both just lethal after that anyway, right? So, oh, actually, no, they're both at 7. Oh, interesting. They both are actually at 7 toughness. So if I bolster here, it puts an extra counter here. It basically gets me 2 more, which still doesn't actually put us at lethal. It puts us at 13. So I'm just going to hit and leave my opponent on 4, which basically means that they have to deal with both of these cards. Like, these are both lethal threats that are incredibly difficult to deal with. Are we going to win on a mold of 5 here? I think we mold of 5 this game, right? Yeah, I think so. This is... We are certainly in the driver's seat as it sits. Not out of it quite yet, though. A sweeper, you know, something like a Crux of Fate could do some serious work here. Screamreach Brawler, not quite the answer, though. All right, and it's a Soul Flare. With Trample. Which is not really that scary. So we'll bolster onto this thing because it grows both of them. Now, they're both lethal, of course. Yeah, let's just attack with both. And then anything that gets blocked, we're just going to whisk away. Because it basically just means that our opponent has to keep chump blocking. And it blanks their draw step. They're on 0 card, so it just ensures the victory, basically. Well, it sort of ensures the victory. Let's see here. If I whisk away, it puts a Screamreach Brawler back on top. Now, this is actually, I think it's actually better just to do it this way. Sure, our opponent does get one rip, but I can't. It's really hard to imagine a card that actually kills us. We can kill the Soul Flare or whisk it away. We have both options available, and we're also going to have the Cleric back to block. So I think this works out fine. Keeping one land in hand just in case we get mind rotted so we can keep one, or, you know, keep our whisk away available. All right, we did it. That was sweet. Oof, that was good. Opponent's deck is scary. I wish we had... you know, like a fog effect for the first time in my life. I actually wish we had one of those double, what's it called? Volcanic whatever is pretty raw. Maybe we bring in the negate, you know, because the one thing about that card is that it's like Trumpet Blast. It says attacking creatures get that, which of course means that they must commit to the attack beforehand. And so like imagine the scenario that we found ourselves in that game when we blew out our opponent with the flip and the activation and all that. If we had just blocked normal and they tap out for volcanic whatever, then we negate it and our blocks are still great. So it is actually quite good. I don't love how you know, conditional it can be, though. That I think that part is a little bit annoying. But that said, it's probably worth it. We've seen those two, and there's bound to be removal spells and such as well. You know, which can be really annoying, too. So we'll go ahead and bring in the negate. What are we going to cut, though? Everything here is fine against our opponent. There's nothing that's just awful. We got those cards out already. We really want these early plays as much as possible. I think I like the warrior now. Being able to block and trade from the early stages is pretty good. The territorial rock, you know, holds its own. I could cut the enhanced awareness. It's sort of our late game play, but we've got a lot of action to sort of keep us moving along. So I'll cut enhanced awareness. It's a 5 drop. It's a little clunky. Doesn't affect the board if we're under a lot of pressure. So we'll bring in the negate for that. All right, this looks good. Being on the draw here is a little annoying because I'd love to get this infiltrator down and rolling right away, but we do get to anticipate. I will probably just fire off the anticipate right away here. If we don't have any other plays, I will for sure do that. And then our first play is going to be this Jeskai Infiltrator, most likely. Our first creature, at least. Reckless Imp, great, no problem. You know, taking the 2 is slightly annoying, but the fact that it doesn't stick is huge. Well, there's an Erishin Cleric. So the option here is to play Erishin Cleric, but that makes our Infiltrator a little bit worse. But I think we do it. I can get in a little extra damage this way. I get the life gain. And also, if our opponent's plan is just to play the what's it called? The imp, that's not going to work. Oh, our opponent's plan is to dash the imp this turn and presumably miss a land drop. That could be great for us. Oh, yeah, this is really great for us. All right, it might be our turn to run good here. Let's find out. Opponent's missing lands. We had to mulligan a bunch. And we certainly ran poorly in the first game. And our opponent is now officially running like garbage as well. Not a glorious way to go out, but it puts us in a strong commanding position here as they're now discarding to hand size. Okay, so let's rumble. I want to see what we get off of the infiltrator here. So we got an island. Okay. And here, I think it's probably correct to just play Warrior and Rock. This just puts out the most power. I mean, Rock is a little disappointing. It might maybe anticipates a little better. But, I mean, now we've just got this huge board state. And our opponent is incredibly behind. And they're going to scoop it up. All right. So we did it. We took down the draft with this pretty sweet blue-white deck. Like I said, this is one of the color combos that I like. I don't love, but I like. I will certainly play it when I think that it's correct. And I think that was a fine draft for it. You know, not a home run by any stretch, but a solid deck with some good stuff. And I think it was cool that we got to see sort of the full range on Gleam as well. I mean, it won a match for us when we won a turn sooner than I anticipated. And it also won that last one where we mulliganed and were able to keep those creatures alive and get them big enough to be, you know, where they couldn't get burned out and they were just bigger than anything our opponent was doing. And that was, you know, we were in a tough spot there. But we also got 2-for-1 with it almost immediately in one of our games. And that's something that happens as well when you do these. So I think we got to see kind of the ups and the downs of playing a card like that, which is important to consider when you're taking it. My conclusion has been so far that the ups outweigh the downs and it's worth it. But it's the downs are still there and you have to consider them. If you guys want to find me on Twitter to say hi or give me any feedback, you can find me at Marshall_LR. You can also listen to the podcast Limited Resources with myself and with Louis Scott Vargas every week here on Channel Fireball or over at LRcast.com. Thanks for hanging out, guys. We'll see you next time.